Today, our guest speaker is going to be Ronnie Kamari. And she's going to speak to us on the role commitment plays in ending suffering. So open up, get ready. Ashaka.
Ashaka.
Yeah, but you got to turn it up a little bit.
Turn it up some, okay. Today, what I'm going to talk about is the role commitment plays for ending suffering. And this is a big subject. And I'm not going to cover everything that it entails, but I'm going to go into it a little bit. I'm happy that I had a chance to give Satsang today, and this has given me another opportunity to look more deeply into myself in regards to this matter. And hopefully I may say something or share something that can be used in your own exploration of the considerations that the Guru has recently given us. Before we look together into the nature and making of commitment, I want to talk about the suffering part of the title. Many of us have been asked to do self-observation and meditative retrospection, so I feel like there are some in the room who are able to consider the matter along with me this morning. The Bible says, we suffer because of our lack of understanding, our lack of knowledge. And according to the Bible, as an unenlightened man or woman, the condition of suffering is a given. However, the commandment given to us as initiates is to inspect this nature of suffering within our own life and living, so we can see in our own case and for ourselves if this is indeed the case. Without doing the work of inspection to the point of seeing, truly seeing or realizing our condition, no happiness can be found. When I do this experiment, it's self-evident, but if I don't look, I can't see that I'm suffering. When I sit my life in the palm of my hands, I see a lot of things. I've seen my quest in this world as a very usual and ordinary person. You know, I have followed the path of worldly concerns and went through the ordinary progression of what to do with my life, pursue pleasure, and I sought to avoid pain. I desired to be known and important and was concerned that people recognized me for my so-called accomplishments. The praise felt good and I felt appreciated. I put a lot of energy into acquiring things, and if you just come to my house, you'll see the evidence of that one there. A lot of stuff. You know, things aren't great or grand, they're just things. So my desires and strategies to become permanently happy, it led to many pursuits. But all have failed to give me any lasting happiness. And I know that many of us have taken initiation, but you know, are we still holding out in pursuit of worldly concerns in the hopes of ending our suffering and finding lasting happiness? And now, you know, I pose that question to us. Even though we've gone over and over the teachings many times, we've heard a lot of teachings, in spite of the teachings that we've heard, are we still looking? And are we looking in the world? I wanted to read just a short story from the Tales of the Mystic East on the lost in the taste of honey, because it kind of addresses what we do sometimes here in this world. It says, everyone is caught up in worldly activities. No thought is given to finding a solution. Man remains oblivious to the cycle of birth and death, being foolish and ignorant under the sway of his mind. And this is a quote from Guru Nanak. So here's the story to give you an idea how foolish we really are. And it says, listen to this. A king left his palace one morning on horseback for a ride in the countryside and went further afield than usual. After riding for several hours, he became lost in a deep and almost impenetrable jungle. Reining in his horse, he looked about him and was terror-stricken as he saw a tiger coming towards him. He leaped from his horse, quickly climbed a nearby tree, and sat on one of its branches. The tiger came to the same tree and sat on his haunches, waiting to devour the king whenever he came down. Seeing this, the king began to test the branch on which he was sitting to make certain it was strong enough to bear his weight. But as he looked along its length, he was filled with fear, for he saw that two mice, one white and the other black, were gnawing away at the branch where it joined the tree. What can I do? The king exclaimed, almost beside himself with terror. I am trapped, and there is no way of escape. He looked down at the ground to see where he would fall when the branch gave way, and whether the earth below was hard or soft. But here another terrifying sight met his gaze. Beside the tiger, there was a huge python with its jaws wide open, waiting for him to fall. And the king trembled in fright. As he clung to the branch, wondering what he might do to save himself, he suddenly saw that honey was dripping from a branch above his head. So he began to lick it. And as he did so, the honey had an amazing effect. The king, absorbed in its sweetness, soon became completely oblivious to his danger. The tiger, the mice, and the python were all forgotten as he became more and more enchanted with the taste of the marvelous honey. In a short time, of course, the mice gnawed through the branch, it fell to the ground, and the king, with a happy smile on his lips, was killed. Who is the king in this story? It says, we are. Death is the tiger who watches all our actions. He keeps count of every minute of our lives. The white and black mice are day and night, and they are cutting down the tree of our lives. A day gone by will never return. The python is the funeral pyre, or the grave that waits to consume us. And the grave tells us that, according to Bara Farid, ultimately you have to come to me. So why fear death? The honey is the world and its ephemeral pleasures, whose taste seems so sweet. We are so absorbed in the world that we do not notice its dangers. In fact, we say to ourselves, this life is sweet. Who has seen the next? So, I want you to play Alicia Keys for me, please. Just want you to listen to this song a little bit, just to sink in some more about what we do, looking for worldly pursuits. Baby,
Some people search for a fountain.
Song says that there are many, many things in life to choose. Which one did you choose? And are or were they worth it? Did they make you happy, or are you still suffering? The worldly choices were pursued when I had only looked at my life superficially. I may not have thought it was superficial at that time, but with some reflection, inspection, and retrospection, it helped me get clear about it. Maybe it did for you as well. You know, being a husband, a wife, a parent, or being famous or rich or highly praised, did it scratch you where you itch? You know, did it fulfill your greatest need? Or is there something else that you see? You know, the master recently posed a question at Satsang, and he asked, what will you do with this life? And as he has done so many times, the master has asked us in some shape, form, or fashion many times, what will we devote our lives to? And he has implored us to set our lives in the palms of our hands and take a look at it. The mystics ask that we choose and follow them, and the choice depends on just as many things as we have considered for our life prior to coming to the path. What I have seen throughout my life was the underlying current of suffering. You know, it didn't matter what else was going on in my life, I could feel it, and I was not as happy as I wanted to be. You know, I was suffering. How do you know when this suffering is your ailment? You know, I know I'm suffering when I'm in bondage to the negative states of mind, because these negative states of mind are derived from fear. You know, the lust, the anger, the greed, the attachment, and the vanity, all of that is coming from a state of fear. The master has talked about this suffering many times and in many satsangs. I know I kind of visited a couple of satsangs that I can't get no satisfaction. I visited suffering, its causes, and its ending. But those are just two titles. But when we attend that song and listen closely, you know, we notice it's embedded in a lot of Seth's songs. He talks about this suffering. It's in the books and everything. So hearing this Dharma, reading the Dharma, you know, all of that didn't matter. You know, I even made a confession in my cooler group how, you know, I attend that song, you know. I call myself doing Seva. I do my meditation, but yet I'm still suffering. So, you know, what was up with that? And the master, you know, he set me straight about it too. I'll touch that a little bit later. But just to see that I was suffering, no real change or chance of ending it could happen until I took that look in my very own life, in my very own depth. Self-observation has shown me that my behavior is shaped by my suffering. I saw that, and I saw that when I'm suffering, I'm going to do something regretful, and that's full of errors, because I'm operating from a mind full of ill will, and I'm held hostage by the perversions. You know, but suffering, clearly I don't know who, what, or why I am, because I'm too consumed to know anything else. Suffering is a state of fear, and suffering is based on my complaint or some present aspect of reality. You know, I got a grumble going on. I may become angry, mistrustful, full of doubt. You know, these are all the makings of what's embedded in this suffering. And any chance at humaneness is just absolutely co-opted when I'm suffering. You know, when I'm suffering, it is self first, second, last, and I'm going to attempt to relieve myself of suffering at any cost to whoever and whatever. To those who have done the work, you have your own observation of how suffering looks on you. But I would say it's ugly. And it's an absolutely horrible feeling and sight to suffer all over the place. And even worse, when the infection and the dis-ease of suffering is smeared onto others, you know, that we encounter, especially the ones we so-called love. You know, I'm sure many people around me during times when I was suffering probably asked, you know, what love got to do with that? Because in a state of suffering, you know, I'm far away. I'm at the farthest possible distance from love when I'm suffering. The master says if we are suffering, it's because we are not practicing rightly. He said we, superficial, mechanical, ceremonious, haphazard, failures, breakdowns of being regular, punctual, and giving full time to the practice, don't end suffering. And God forbid no practice at all. But, you know, the Lord sends compassionate souls into this world so that those who are suffering can become free. The saints have invited us to learn how to partake of their condition by offering to us to come, all who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. But to be set free of suffering, there must first be a realization that suffering exists in our life. Once the inspection has been done and we are consciously aware of our suffering and our utter denial about it, there's work to be done to be free. If wanting to could have freed me from suffering, the task would have been done a long time ago. But wanting to wasn't it. That didn't get that kind of work done. And I want to ask Prabhupada to play one more song to get here if you can. Because the nature of the work that we have to do to end this suffering, it's going to take a tremendous effort. And listen to this song here, and then get a gist of how much work got to be put in. Because the masters, they take everything. And this song gonna talk about everything and anything to get to where we need to be to get this work done. So once you've inspected your life and seen that you had some suffering in it, and you made a decision to do something about that suffering, there's work to be done. And this work gonna take a gallant effort. It's gonna be your great and mighty walk. Because just like in the worldly pursuits that we've chosen over time, it took time, energy, and attention, and the effort of determination, perseverance, and a strong will to do what was necessary. And no less is required on the path. Ego is the greatest addiction. And as Bob once says, it will take everything to do this work. Ego is the sum total of all our conditioning, beliefs, false shortcomings, fantasies, and self-proclamations. Because we've misidentified our true self, what our idea is of self. Through ego, we've created a Frankenstein. And Frankensteinian though it may be, we love our own egoic creation. We love it. But remember the story. In Frankenstein, the monster killed its originator. And that's what the ego gonna do to us. It's gonna kill us. Maybe that can become a motivator for some of us, you know. Unless we're too crazy to get this lesson, it's hard going to say. We talked a lot about that in that song, we're too crazy. He also says there is no happiness for the crazy person and that they will always suffer. When I reflect on my life, I look to see what was going on with me for things I felt I've been committed about. And what I noticed was that no matter how or why I became involved in something, I had to make a conscious decision and then make a deliberate effort to continue or not continue a thing. And I had to stay with it. And the commitment made me devoted to it. With commitment, I'm willing to tackle my fears, and I have the focus, the energy, and the will to go forth with a gallant effort. I become courageous and bold. I ain't haphazard and sloppy about it. What I do is deliberate, and everything else going on in my life is subservient and secondary to my cause. In my egoic pursuits, I have tried to remove or demolish whatever was in the way of achieving my goal, and I rode those ups and downs and was willing to make necessary changes for meeting the goal. When my mind was made up, my attitude was, you know, come hell or high water. My intention is to go forth. And any sacrifices that I had to make, they felt more like something that just needed to be done to meet the goal, you know. I didn't stew over the choice. You know, having a ruthless edge is egoic, but spiritual commitment requires perseverance, which means there's an urgency and an insistence. It requires determination. Determination is a staying power and bravery and an indomitable will. And you got to be strong and have a motivated force or spirit. And the master calls this cuckoo. You know, I worked at a law firm for many years, and I noticed how some of the young lawyers come in, they call them associates. And, you know, they come in with the zest of academia and they want to make a lot of money and stuff like that. And I noticed over time who ended up making the money. And there was the ones who stayed there all the time. They didn't go home. They lived and breathed that job. And, you know, and they did what it took to make that money. And by the time they reached that goal, you know, they may not have had a wife anymore. They may not have had a girlfriend no more, because they had to consciously choose every time it came up, am I going to stay or am I going to go? But if that money was their overriding thing that they wanted, they stayed. They stayed. And they underwent the consequences of their action. And a lot of times, you know, we may not realize what the consequences are going to be for some of the actions we have or take, but there are always some there. And I would say doing the practice is like staying at work. You know, even when the body and the mind doesn't want to, as an initiate, Simran, Bhajan, Dhyan, and the feeling contemplation of the guru creates the context or the ways and means for what I want to have a chance of occurring. You know, Bogdan says, ultimately, grace gets the work done. But just no, so no one falls into delusion about it, doing the practice is the evidence of interest in fulfilling the stated goal. More fundamental than wanting to know myself and God is that I want my suffering to end. I can't even think about knowing a higher self or God, you know, if I'm suffering. Because suffering means I'm too distracted to think about anything other than me and my and mine. And that right there is an immense contraction. You know, I'm all balled up inside. I can't blossom and I ain't open to know anything. You know, I'm just dense, you know, just ignorant and closed and in darkness and full of error, you know, what some people call sin. You know, in that state of being, you know, how can I ever see light or be open to what needs to be done to have knowledge of self or anything else for that matter? It is commitment that gives me the willingness to take a chance. Yes, I may be fearful, but I am not crippled by the fear to the point of not acting. Being committed is not being paralyzed. Being committed is energetic, it's strong, it's dedicated. And dedicated also means having a degree of fidelity, because I'm not looking to have my need met in something or somewhere else. You know, Bogdan talked to us good about looking for things in places that they don't exist. You know, and that's a lesson of life. Being committed requires a degree of maturity. You know, little girls, little boys, and teenagers want their own way. And there's no Bodhisattva spirit within them. To be committed takes a lot of growing up. And responsible grown-ups have enough will to do what is in their best interest, and therefore have taken a few knocks to cultivate some ability to cut through selfishness, resistance, and reluctance to do what the mind, the body, and emotions don't want to do. Because grown-ups do what needs to be done for the good of self and for those whom they are in relationship with. That's being responsible, which is another act of being committed, you know, because otherwise the goals of little kids change from moment to moment. But life takes a lot of growing up, and growing up is learning the lessons of life. Many times we do grow up and become grown and reach adulthood, but the suffering of living is such that we are on the edge of insanity, you know, just crazy again, as Bogdan says. But the Dharma giver gives the lessons of life in such a way that it heals me of the schism within my being. And, you know, when I hear the Dharma and the Master ask me to sit my life in the palm of my hands, I can sometimes see what he's telling me about life. Because of his kindness and compassion, I'm able to see my suffering, learn some lessons, you know, and not just want to blow my brains out about it all. The Bible says, happy is the man that findeth wisdom and the man that getteth understanding. And what wisdom and knowledge have we obtained so far since we've been on this earth? You know, the Masters say the wisdom is knowledge of self, true self. How much of that do we have? You know, and understanding is knowing and accepting reality. And do we live our life based on our wisdom, you know? Or are we doing the opposite? You know, what are we really doing and what have we done? When I look over my life, I've seen moments of happiness and then a return to suffering. And the Master tells me that there is no way to be happy unless you've achieved self-realization. He said identification with the body, mind, is suffering. And as as I opened Seth's song, you know, I talked about that we suffer because of our lack of knowledge and knowledge of ourselves. The master says that ego is an activity. Probably many people have heard that lots of times, that ego is an activity. And in order to end the activity of ego, it has to be replaced with another activity. He says the activity to replace ego is observation and do it moment to moment, because that's how ego is made. Ego is made moment to moment by misidentifying ourselves as body, mind, and emotions. So observation is the thing to do to be free of that. He said, because observation is a different activity than identifying with the body, the mind, and the emotions. I wanted to say that too, because, you know, Bhagwan asked me to come up here and tell the truth today. I know that we have some people in the house who were newly initiated. We have some people now who are also online for initiation. And just to tell the truth what this path is all about. This path is and was always about, you know, bringing suffering to an end. And in bringing suffering to an end, the ego got to die. That is the function of the guru, of the master, is to kill this ego of ours. And we have to be willing to do that. In the egoic condition, suffering is inherent. You just can't get around that. And it's only when we suffered enough, or when the back gets up against the wall, where we have no more options, do we sometimes get the willingness to want to do that work to overcome this suffering and do what must be done. He said that it's observation, and there is no other way. Ain't no other way. Instead of identifying with the body, mind, and emotions, doing the egoic thing, just observe it. Do the observation. That is the only thing he says will set you free of this. During the course of the week, so much has been said to me. My mind really is swimming. One obstacle and barrier for becoming committed is fear. And he talked about that as well, because he said fear is mind-based. And if, as an ego, you got to overcome your body, mind, and emotions, then fear being mind-generated, that must be overcome as well. Mm-hmm. And the way to overcome that is to let that go and observe. Just observe. Just be the observer. And ultimately find that witnessing self. And you have to do it moment to moment, because that's how the attack is coming. The attack comes moment to moment by identifying as ego, and the war has to come moment by moment. Got to meet it with the same force. But nobody's going to change when they don't see anything that needs to be fixed or is wrong with them. You know, when there is no love and no trust, all kinds of fear and doubt, only your own sin can motivate you to change. But be brave and do yourself a favor. Just look, consider, and be honest with yourself. You know, this dharma is sweet, and it's here to help cure us of what ails us. That's what the guru is here for. But you have to choose and be willing to be instructed by the guru and do this egoic work. Also running through this, I couldn't get around talking about being committed to the guru, because the guru is the giver of light that shines through my darkness. I wouldn't have had a clue to how to end my suffering had I not been told first, then, you know, made an effort to try that. But if we can't even have a vested interest in bringing our suffering to an end, you know, how are we going to be committed to the guru? We're not even committed to ourselves and what is in our own best interest as well. Being committed to the guru means follow his instructions and doing the practice. And, you know, if we don't even do it in his face, then, you know, what is that saying about us? Probably not doing the practice either. So, I think sometimes, like, the cry of the soul is like, you know, little Anthony and the Imperials when they sing that song, On the Outside Looking In. You know, that's an angst. That's suffering right there. And I don't want to go back on the inside alone. So I choose the guru. I need a guide. I need somebody to take me in and show me the way. Mm-hmm. Hold my hand and whatever it takes. Mm-hmm. And the master is here. He's just waiting for our invitation to come in to enthrone him. So, I choose that. I choose to live this. And I want to do this practice to the point that it actually becomes my life and living, and do what he says needs to be done. And one thing I can say is that In doing some of the practice, when he told me that, how could I be attending satsang and doing seva and things of that nature and still be suffering, he told me that, you know, I wasn't doing the practice right. And that was true. So I had to revisit that right there, because I had experiences where I know in the practice that the eyes disappear when the practice is done rightly. It don't exist at all. And it's a whole different feeling than my feeling of being my normal egoic self. So I know the practice does work, but none of us could ever know it works if we don't do it and do it rightly and with the right intention. You know, he said that the path is not here to be mixed in to the egoic condition to make that better. The path is here to destroy the ego. And just, you know, be clear about it. Be clear about it. I'm just gonna cut it short. I'm gonna ask the Prabhupada to play my last song, and then I'll take questions, if there are any. the OJs.
Thank you.
other songs, I just could not get around being committed to the guru. You know, it makes everything else possible. Everything else possible. And that's the underlying thread through this whole practice, is being committed to the master. You know, before we came on the path, we had a chance to check out the path. We had a chance to see what it was all about. And it was always about, and it's still about, being committed to the master, to the Dharma giver, to the guru, to the one who sets you free, if we do the work. If we do the work. So that's probably the strongest point I can make today, except for the few little things that I told you he had mentioned about the self-observation. The self-observation is to replace the egoic activity. Do that activity. Observe. Are there any questions? Mananda?
Yes, and you read the part where the story that you said the king ate the honey.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't get the moral of the story.
Okay. Well, you know that the king was up in the tree, right?
Yeah.
And he had the tiger and the snake at the bottom just waiting for him to fall down so they could get him. And then at the end of the branch, he had the two mice, the black and the white mice. They represented the night, and they were gnawing at the limb, so he knew it was going to fall. But just as he was up there in that tree, he happened to see some honey. And so he started eating the honey, and he became absorbed in it to the point that, you know, when the limb fell, he fell smiling, because it represents that we become so distracted in the world that we are not focused on the fact that we are going to die. And when we get caught up in it, you know, these worldly pursuits, they seem to be so sweet to us until we're just oblivious that we're going to die. You know, like I talked about earlier, these worldly pursuits, we didn't try to do a whole lot of things in life that we thought was going to make us happy, right? And the clock been ticking all while we keep trying to do these other things. And, you know, the other things that we did, you know, did they make us happy? Did they stop our suffering, you know? Or did we get so caught up that we couldn't even see that we were suffering? So this is the moral of the story, is we get too caught up in life and we don't pay attention to what is important.
In your own personal self-observation, which one of the drishti between dosha, bhana, and mithya would you say affect your suffering the most?
I would say a lack of dosha drishti, you know, seeing things for how they are and accepting it and not to blame. You know, because my suffering as an ego is that I want things to be the way that I want them to be. And that's in direct conflict with dosha drishti. Is that Ronnie?
I just had a little inquiry about the symbolism of the honey and whether or not the honey could represent the ability to forget about the self through love of the master, or the, you know, that aspect of things.
Not in this story.
Okay.
Yeah, this is just strictly about worldly desires. That was something in the world. He got lost in that. But you think it? He started thinking about his master.
I don't know. Yeah. That's what came to me when you were reading it. That the only way. The honey, if it represents the ego, how could that help him? You know, I don't understand.
Well, it started out with that. Everyone is caught up in worldly activities. No thought is given to finding a solution. Man remains oblivious to the cycle of birth and death, being foolish and ignorant under the sway of his mind. But I don't know. I won't try to. I don't know. Everybody probably gets something different. Anoka-san?
Can you talk about the basic practice and how it relates to this commitment of, or even being able to observe yourself?
The basic practice is the foundation, because with the basic practice, we encounter all the things that need to be confronted and overcome in order to do the practice. To do the basic practice, you know, we got to get out of bed when we don't want to. We got to practice when we're probably sleepy. And we got to meet challenges in basic practice. So when basic practice is not being done regularly, punctually, and full time, you're not meeting the challenges of the body, mind, emotions. And body, mind, and emotions is what must be destroyed. Basic practice every day is an opportunity to confront that and do battle with it.